glad you're here. Let's stand all over the building. Pastor Rudy Smith, if you'll step up here. Brother Rudy, so good to have you. I think they had a van or busload last night, may have some more tonight. We appreciate this dear man of God been laboring faithfully for the Lord many, many years at Mount Sinai Baptist Church in Pickens, South Carolina. It's an honor to have him, Brother Shook, so many others, Brother Shelton right here, Brother Mayo, just so many others. We're glad you're here. Brother Chuck, God bless you. Good to see you. Preacher, if you'll pray with us, and then we're going to let you be seated, and our choir's going to sing two or three songs. We're going to have maybe one special, and then we'll turn our first preacher loose real soon. Here's why. Because I don't want these men of God to feel we're not one bit rushed. Not one bit rushed. We like preaching, amen? We like preaching. You'll find that out, all right, Brother Rudy? God bless you. Would you pray for this service tonight?
Our Father, in the name of Jesus, we want to thank you for the privilege to be here tonight. Thank you, God, for the good meeting we've heard of thus far. And I pray, God, the power of God will still be moving throughout this service tonight. Touch and anoint the choir now, Lord. And then, God, I pray for Brother Joe, you touch him. And Brother Falour, you touch him. And, Lord, give Brother Steve wisdom as he directs the service. And, Lord, most of all, will you come by and meet with us, minister to us, Lord. We're a needy people, Lord. You don't need us, but we sure enough do need you. Come by and take over, Lord. Manifest your power and your glory. And God will praise you for all you do. In Jesus' name, amen.
One stanza. Brethren, we met to worship. You ready? You ready? You got it? Let's sing it.
Brethren, we have met to worship.
Sing it. Come on, sing it. Come on.
Is to me my everything, and I bless the day he came, when he gave me drink from the fountain sweet, and I'll never thirst again. Now through the Spirit of the Son to the Father I can say, for your saving blood and for all you've done, bless the Lord, and
oh, bless the Lord, yes, bless the Lord, well, bless his holy name. Let me not forget all his benefits or the blessings that.
I remember the joy that I had as a boy when he saved me. What a thrill that I had. I was happy and glad when I knew that he heard my cry. Some of my friends try to say when I get a little older, the fire in my soul will grow a little colder. But what I got was more than a dose of religion. I became a genuine born-again Christian, and I'm still around to stand and testify. I still get a prayer. I'm knowing the Lord saved me. I still got a prayer for the joy that came me. I still got a soul on fire, and it's still burning higher. When I think about his mercy, I still want to sing for my Lord and King who became my sacrifice. I still get a lump in my throat and a tear on my face when I listen to the words of amazing grace. And I still get moved and excited in the presence of the God who delighted in giving his only son to pay his price. I still get a prayer. Knowing the Lord saved me, I still got a feel for the joy that he gave me. I still got a soul on fire, and it's still burning higher. And I can't get over the love that I feel, and I still get a thrill. I still get a thrill out of knowing the Lord saved me. I still got a feel.
Everybody shake hands, cross the aisle, tell somebody you love them, all right? Brother Burgess, if you'll come on up here, Brother Burgess. Everybody cross the aisle. Everybody tell somebody you love somebody. How many of you tonight, how many are truly, truly glad you're in the house of God? What a blessing. You know what you were before conversion, right? You know where you were. But thanks to Calvary. Thanks to Calvary. Not the man we used to be, all right? All of our preachers, our pastors, evangelists, missionaries, young preachers, I want you to stand, all right? I'm not going to get every name, but I want to recognize you. And I want to say thank you, every one of you, for being here tonight in the house where we've had some had to come and go, some had to leave, and others have came in tonight. Thank you, men. God bless every one of you. We love you. We want you to know, as Dr. Robbins used to say, we're in your corner, all right? Thank you. You may be seated, all right? We don't do a lot of this here, but I want Mark and Michelle to stand up, if you will. I know they won't like it. Stand up real quick. I want to publicly thank you for coordinating, supervising, working, laboring, and getting all these delicious meals, all right? They're the team responsible for getting all these meals. By the way, we got some jam-up food we're going to eat in a little while. But thank you very, very much. And a large team of workers, a large team of workers. But listen, somebody had to be in charge. And so y'all's in charge. Let's give them a great big round of applause, all right? Thank you. Come on, brother. I love this man. He's the only man we booked to sing. I'm serious. And I didn't really book him. I just called him and said, I'd love for you to sing at the meeting. And we got tons of singers, but I'm going to get our first preacher in a minute. And we're going to hear preaching tonight all night long. Well, not all night. But this is Brother James Burgess, and I promise you he'll be a blessing, all right?
How great thou art.
that. He's a great God. Amen. And watch it. And greatly to be praised. Greatly to be praised. Come on, Pastor, if you will. This is Brother Tim Fuller from Milton, Florida. He pastors the Victory Baptist Church. No stranger here. And we love this man, and we want you to hear him. And plenty of time for Dr. Arthur in a little while. Let me thank Dr. Arthur. You know, yesterday he couldn't be with us, but he had to help with the funeral, Brother Stennett Ballou, and we're so glad you was able to make it this morning, even and all day today. May God bless you. All right, preacher, God bless you. The pulpit's yours. Take all the time you need.
Thank you. 1 Kings chapter 12 tonight. 1 Kings 12th chapter, while you're turning there. Thank you, preacher, one more time for the privilege of being here. Grateful for the invitation. Third year that I've been able to be here. I think all 3 years of the Jubilee. And what an honor, and thank you so much. And just a real privilege to be here. And I appreciate everybody who works behind the scenes to put a meeting on like this. Takes a lot of volunteers. And thank God for the nursery workers as well, right? I stopped by the nursery just a little bit ago, and I said, I'm praying that y'all have record attendance in the nursery tonight. I don't think they appreciated that, to be honest with you. But thank God for everybody that has worked and put it together, and just a privilege to be here. 1 Kings chapter 12, I'm going to get right into the message tonight, and looking forward to hearing my grandpa preach here in just a minute. 1 Kings chapter number 12. I know two things. I know that the message that I'm getting ready to preach is not a camp meeting message. I know it is the message that God has laid on my heart. So I'm going to do my best just to obey the Lord, let him do what he wants to with it, and then Brother Arthur will come in just a minute. 1 Kings chapter 12, verse 12, so Jeroboam and all the people came to Rehoboam the third day, as the king had appointed, saying, come to me again the third day. And the king answered the people roughly and forsook the old men's counsel that they gave him, and spake to them after the counsel of the young men, saying, my father made your yoke heavy, and I will add to your yoke. My father also chastised you with whips, but I will chastise you with scorpions. Verse 16, so when all Israel saw that the king hearkened not unto them, the people answered the king, saying, what portion have we in David? Neither have we inheritance in the son of Jesse. To your tents, O Israel, now see to thine own house, David. So Israel departed unto their tents. Verse 19, so Israel rebelled against the house of David unto this day. And it came to pass, when all Israel heard that Jeroboam was come again, that they sent and called him unto the congregation and made him king over all Israel. There was none that followed the house of David but the tribe of Judah only. 1 Kings chapter 11 and 12, companion chapters, they give us the historical background for how the nation of Israel goes from a united kingdom to a divided kingdom. The nation had been a monarchy for 40 years under the reign of King David, 40 years under King David, 40 years under King Solomon. But when Solomon died, there was a political division amongst the tribes that would rend the kingdom in two. And from henceforth, you read about the 10 tribes of the north, that's Israel, the 2 tribes of the south, that's Judah. It was really a sad time in Israel's history when the reign of Solomon came to an end. A king who had been devoted to God, a king who had built the temple, a king who had offered thousands of sacrifices in that temple, but a king who also had married strange women who turned his heart away from God. And God came to Solomon at the end of his life and told him that he was going to rend the kingdom in two. Instead of his son serving in his stead, he was going to give the kingdom to a servant. And Solomon spent the last days of his life knowing that his son would become the next king, but he wouldn't be able to hold on to the kingdom. And he knew that the nation was going to divide and that most of them would follow a servant as a sad end to what had been a glorious beginning. Solomon dies. His son Rehoboam is anointed as the next king of Israel. The entire record of his life is found in 1 Kings chapter 12 and 1 Kings chapter 14. There's a couple of chapters in Chronicles that are companion chapters. And here's the thing about Rehoboam. You will look long and hard to find anything positive said about Rehoboam. Usually you can find some good in even the worst of men, but Scripture paints a very honest portrait of a brash, immature, reckless young man. He reigns for 17 years, dies at the age of 58, goes down in history as the first evil king of Judah. His mother was from Ammon. That's one of the heathen women that Solomon married, and she brings her idolatry into the home, and she must have had a greater influence on him than Solomon did, because he turned out more like his mother than he did his father. And when Rehoboam was inaugurated as king, we read that a delegation of citizens came to him with a request. The request simply is for lower taxes. Solomon had evidently levied heavy taxes against the people to pay for his building projects, and they had become oppressive. And so the delegation comes to Rehoboam, and they pledge that if you will not be as heavy-handed as your father was, if you would give us some relief, then we will gladly serve you as our king. Rehoboam says, give me 3 days to think about it and take counsel and to ponder as to what kind of king that I want to be. And so he takes counsel with a group of older advisors who advise him that this is a wise move. But then a group of young millennials who take the more socialist approach that we ought to spread the wealth around and the rich need to pay more, they have a different idea. It is always dangerous, by the way, to have young men who have no wisdom, no experience, never built anything, never held out a job, to have them running a country. These young men very foolishly appealed to Rehoboam's vanity and said that you have every right to demand anything that you want. And so this is what Rehoboam decided that he would do. He comes back to the representatives and he said, you just thought that it was hard. I'm not going to lower your taxes. I'm going to raise your taxes. I'm going to rule with an iron fist. I'm going to make your life more difficult. I'm going to prove to be as oppressive as I am immature. And with that, the nation splits in two. 10 tribes get together and they make a decision. Here's the decision. Rehoboam is too immature to be our king, so we have to find another king. We're not going to be treated like this. We deserve better. We're going to start our own thing, and we're going to find us a king that we think will do what we want him to do. We're going to go off. We're going to start our own nation with our own king and our own laws. And wouldn't you know that standing in their midst that very day was the man that they would choose to be their king? His name is Jeroboam. Now, who is Jeroboam? Well, if you look in your Bible to chapter 4, chapter 11, if you will look in verse number 28. In verse number 28, the man Jeroboam was a mighty man of valor, and Solomon, seeing the young man that he was industrious, he made him ruler over all the charge of the house of Joseph. The backstory is that Solomon had had a widow woman who was a servant for him, and she had a son, and that young man grew up in the palace, and he had some very admirable qualities about him as a warrior type. He's a hard worker. He has some leadership skills, and Solomon's elevated him over the house of Joseph. So the tribe of Israel, here's what they do. They make a choice. We choose not to follow Rehoboam as our king. We choose another man to be over us. We choose to find a king who will not be so heavy-handed and who will not be so burdensome in taxes. And while it looks like that it may have been a good choice, I wonder if it was the best choice. Because the king that they chose in chapter 12 will immediately lead those 10 tribes into idolatry and apostasy, and the nation will never recover from the damage that Jeroboam is going to inflict upon those people. Before the Assyrians roll through the land in 722 BC, Israel will have 20 kings, and none of them will be good. And the seeds of their captivity were sown when they said, we choose Jeroboam to be our king. Now please understand, I know that Rehoboam was not a great man. And I know that God had already decreed that the nation is going to be written too. In fact, the prophet had singled out Jeroboam as the man who would take the reins of the split kingdom. But I also know that God has before times hearkened to the prayers of his people and sometimes has turned from one action to another. I know there have been times when God has determined punishment but ended up giving mercy. And though the man of God has prophesied in the previous chapter that this is what would happen, I know that we are responsible for our actions that we take and the decisions that we make. And the people have a choice. And the choice looks good, but is Jeroboam the best choice? I'm not saying Rehoboam was a good man. He's got plenty of negatives. Chief among them is that he's immature and he's brass. But they chose Jeroboam. They picked him. We want you to be our king. Is that the best choice? I think that sometimes when we are facing decisions, we ask the wrong question. Preacher, what is wrong with what I'm doing? Preacher, can you give me a verse? Give me a chapter and verse that tells me I can't do this. I have a better question. Is it right? It may not be a sin, but are you sure that is God's will? Are you trying to find out how much you can get away with, or are you trying to find out what God's will and what God's best is for your life? And when you are making a potentially life-altering decision, you should want to know, is this the best choice and is this God's choice for my life? I understand this is not shouting material, but I would like to help somebody tonight from making a mistake that you may end up having to pay for years on end. Because when you make a decision, you are agreeing to accept the good or the bad that comes with this. I have weighed the pros and the cons, and I believe that there are more pros than there are cons. But what happens a lot of times is that we look at all of the red flags and we say, you know, this could turn south real quick, but I think that I can make it work, and I'll figure it out in the end, and hopefully some negatives won't materialize, and if they do, I can always pray and hope God gets me out of the jam, and I have to have peace about this, even if I have to manufacture some peace myself. But if I ask the right people, and if I keep talking about it, I will eventually persuade myself against myself, and that is a good way to get yourself in trouble for a long time down the road. So when you are making a choice, you need to know, is this the best choice? Maybe the decision is about a mate. That's a big decision. Maybe the choice is in marriage. Maybe it's about a ministry. Maybe the decision is about an opportunity to make more money. Maybe it's something as carnal as a big material purchase. But if I believe I can make it work, if all the stars are all aligned just right, and if I put twice as much effort into it, if and you talk yourself into it and convince yourself that you can make it work, and here's all the reasons why I know that it's wrong, but I think that I can make this happen. Are you making the best choice? Is this really God's will for your life? Is the uncertainty, is it a lack of faith, or is it a red flag? Which one is that? And I know that you want God's will for your life, but that's not just whether I should be a missionary to Africa or not. No, you can get out of God's will buying a car. You can get out of God's will buying a house. You can marry out of God's will. You can take a job out of God's will. You can choose a college out of God's will. So how do you know if the choice is the best choice that you ought to be making? I'm hurrying. I'm going to frame it around four questions tonight. I wish that you'd take a pencil and a scrap of paper, and I wish you'd write four questions down, and the next time that you're faced with a big decision, look at those four questions to determine if this is the best choice. Here's the first one. Is this choice the product of much prayer? Now, I hope that you'll not think that I'm making a bigger deal out of this than what it is, but don't miss what is missing in the narrative. Because in 1 Kings chapter 11, the people talked to Jeroboam, they talked to Rehoboam. Rehoboam talks to the counselors. The counselors talk to Rehoboam. Rehoboam comes out and talks to the people, but nobody talks to God. But hey, wait a minute. This is not a light matter. They're making a decision to divide the kingdom, to choose a king, to chart a course for future generations. And nobody in the chapter had enough spirituality to say, we ought to have a prayer meeting. I mean, before we make a decision that's going to impact our families and our children and our worship and our nation, why don't we just get on our knees one time and see if God would help us? Now, maybe you don't think that's a big deal, but maybe you don't think it's a big deal when you make a decision without prayer. Well, preacher, my wife and I, we've talked it over, and I talked to a couple of the lost men on the job, and we're pretty sure it's the right thing because we don't really have a need to pray, and we've done our research. I mean, I've done my due diligence, and I know what questions that I need to ask, and it just feels right, and I know that he's the right man for me because he's so funny, and he's so sweet, and he treats me so good, and how could I love her so much if she's not the one that I should be dating? I know what I want to do. Can I remind you tonight that if any man lack wisdom, let him ask of God, that giveth to all men liberally and upbraideth not, and it shall be given. And can I remind you tonight, call unto me and I will answer thee and show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not. Have you prayed about that? Sir, before you take that job that pays well but moves you to an area where there is no good church to put your family in, please, please pray. Ma'am, before you decide to put that child in daycare and let a stranger raise it so you can go back to work because you don't see how that you can pay your bills on one income, would you please pray? Preacher, before you succumb to that discouragement that it's just suffocating you and you throw in the towel and you look for greener pastures, would you please pray? Sir, before you get offended at something that your pastor says and pulls your family out of a church where God is moving and takes your family somewhere to some watered down, no standards, weak doctrine church that'll soothe your hurt feelings, would you please pray? Young lady, I beg you tonight, before you get so emotionally involved with that young man that your parents say is not a good boy, and you get messed up with a good-looking, sweet-talking worldling that has no spiritual depth to him, would you please stop and pray? There is no indication that they prayed. Where is there a priest to go into the holy place for us? Somebody call for the Urim and the Thummim. Let's get around the temple and see if God will answer us. We need to hear from God. Our children are going to be affected by the decision we're going to make. Is this the best choice? Don't assume that it is God's will because it figures out on paper without praying about it. Don't make the mistake of taking the counsel of lost friends before you take the counsel of God. If you would ask your earthly father for advice, then why wouldn't you ask your heavenly father for advice? Do you pray? And when you pray, do you pray open-mindedly? I'm not talking about asking God to rubber stamp something you've already made your mind up about anyway. Are you asking for God's will, or are you asking for validation of something you've already decided? And don't ask me to pray for something if you're not willing to accept the answer. You say, preacher, what would have happened if they prayed? Well, maybe God would have told them to go back and reason with Rehoboam again and I'll change his mind. Maybe God would have said, you stay there anyway, even though it's immature. I give you the grace to bear it. Maybe he would have said, you know what? It's not going to be Jeroboam. I'll give you somebody else a better direction. Here's the point. We don't know what the answer would have been because they didn't pray. And you don't know what God's answer would be because you've never prayed about it. Ere you left your room this morning, did you think to pray? In the name of Christ our Savior, did you sue for loving favor as a shield for today? Oh, how praying rests the weary. Prayer will change the night to day. So when life seems dark and dreary, don't forget to pray. Preacher, I just wanted to let you know we've decided. Have you prayed about it? The choice makes sense. It's logical. It works out on paper. Your parents don't think it's right, but they don't know the boy like you do. And I'm sure we'll find a good church when we get to that new town, but the job offer is just too good to turn down. But did you pray? I give you the second question tonight. Hurry. Is your choice the product of much prayer? Secondly, will your choice pry open the door for more of the world? Would you look at verse number 20 of chapter 12? Look at verse 20. It came to pass when all Israel heard that Jeroboam was come again. Where was he come again from? We'll come back to chapter 11 and look at verse 40. Solomon sought therefore to kill Jeroboam. And Jeroboam arose and fled into Egypt unto Shishak, king of Egypt, and was in Egypt until the death of Solomon. Jeroboam has angered Solomon. Solomon had put out a warrant for his arrest. So Jeroboam has fled to Egypt. He's been there for the last 9 years. In chapter 12 and verse 2, it came to pass when Jeroboam the son of Nebat, who was yet in Egypt, heard of it, for he was fled from the presence of King Solomon, and Jeroboam dwelt in Egypt. When Solomon passes away, Jeroboam sees it as his chance to come back into the land. So when it says that Jeroboam was come again, he has come again from Egypt. Now you already know that Egypt is a picture of the world. And when God brought the children of Israel out of Egypt, he told them, don't go back. Even the kings are forbidden to go back to Egypt to get their horses. The message is clear. Stay out of Egypt. But Jeroboam has been there for 9 years. You can get a lot of the world in your heart in 9 years. And though he has come out of the world is not out of him. And I wonder if anybody in Israel raised the question, does anybody know if Jeroboam lives like Egypt? Does anybody know if Jeroboam believes like Egypt? Does anybody know if Jeroboam worships the gods of Egypt? Has anybody asked what kind of influence Egypt has upon Jeroboam? And when they took Jeroboam as their king, they took a man who has been immersed in Egyptian culture, and you have to know that that culture has shaped his philosophy of life. If you try to have a godly home where you raise your children, your grandchildren in truth, you have a battle on your hands. And you're going to have enough trouble with the flesh and the devil, just that. So why would you ever pry open the door and let the influence of the world into that hole? The devil is looking for a way to get in. The devil is looking for a way to find a crack in the door, to penetrate that hedge of protection. And when you crack the door open just a little bit and you allow him to stick his foot in the door, that's all that he needs to begin influencing your home. Years ago, it has to be 20, 25 years ago, I remember I visited the home of one of our members. And I remember, I forget what I was there for, but it was just quick, unexpected knock at the door. Had to get in, get something from the man, and walk out. It's just in and out. And so I opened the door. He invited me, and he knew I was coming. And so I come into the living room while he was getting whatever I had to get. And they had the television going on in the living room. Now, I'm not your pastor, right? So I'll be gone in just a minute. They had the television going on, and they were playing CMT. CMT is country music television. It is a channel that just plays country music. Now, I was young and green and dumb and naive, and it just struck me as odd. Why would a Christian family have country music playing in their living room? Has country music gotten better? Maybe it's improved. Maybe it's more wholesome now. I don't know. Did you know that all of the kids in that home have since grown and they're gone, and not one of them is in church tonight? You say, was it because of the country music? I don't know, but I know it sure didn't help them. How could you possibly think that playing that honky-tonk in your home and having gyrating girls on the TV screen and blaring music about drinking and, come on now, and fornicating and cheating on your wife not have an impact on your home? There ought to be some bells going off. So there ought to be a flashing light somewhere that says, this is not going to end well. That old flame that you found on Facebook, you're prying the door open for the word. That friend from school that has nothing in common with Christianity, it's softening your resistance to the world. That music that you play in the car when you're by yourself, it's prying open your heart to more of the world. Those movies that you go to, that television that curses and blasphemes and tells raunchy jokes in your living room, it's yelping your children to think that there's nothing wrong with what I know. I'm killing the service, I understand. While I'm here, you're against country music until it's Christmas time. And I want to hear Vince Gill play whatever. Don't you realize that you are allowing your daughter to develop a taste for that kind of music? Why would you want to bring that into your home and take a chance that it corrupts your children? Why would you allow that influence into your home? Why would you choose the worldly? Are you prying open the door for more of the world? One of the biggest decisions that a family has to make is where and how we will educate our children. Now, I'm not your pastor, and those aren't my kids, all right? Please understand. You better think long and hard before you send your kids to a public school where they're going to be given an Egyptian-based education. They're going to get more indoctrination than they are education. They're going to learn more about the ways of the world than they do the ways of God. They're going to find a friend who's going to introduce them to a part of the world they never knew existed. You're prying open the door for more of the world to come in. In fact, it may surprise you that not every kid that goes to a Christian school is a Christian. The devil has planted a lot of young Trojan horses in Christian schools. He's planted a lot of Trojan horses in youth groups. When our kids were little, you could say that we're not friendly. You could say that we're stuck up. You could say that we're isolationists. But I tell you something, that if my kid ain't being friends with your kid, if I'm not convinced that your kid is a good influence on my kid. I feel like preaching tonight just a little bit. I feel like a little bit. While I'm here, all right, I'm so close to this, I might as well say this. I'm tired of sending our best and brightest off to a Christian college and watch them coming back wanting to play contemporary music in our church. I'm tired of sending our young men off to Bible college and they come back so smart that they don't believe the Bible anymore. I'm tired of sending them off to train for the ministry and they come back as some new IFB and they're better than the old timers and they want to start some ecumenical pseudo-Baptist church. Many a good man has made a choice that pride opened the door. Many a young man has made a choice of a college that pride the door open to the world. Many a family has moved to a church that pride opened the door. Many a teenager has fallen in love with somebody that pride opened the door. And somebody had better ask, are we letting the world into our home? Are we allowing the world to have a say in our future? Is this going to be a gateway for more of the world to come in? Jeroboam is more like Egypt than he is Israel. And you can't immerse yourself in that culture for 9 years without a strong spiritual influence like a church. And it not become a part of you. And you could tell it when he talked. And you could tell it by the way that he walked. You could tell it by the way that he dressed. You could tell it by the philosophy that he had about the issues of the day. And they said, we know that he has Egypt in his heart, but we choose you to be our king. Is your choice prying open the door for more of the world? I'm hurrying. I give you the third question. Question 3. Does your choice presume a loyalty is not there. Look at chapter 12, and verse 26. Jeroboam said in his heart, "Now shall the kingdom return to the house of David. If this people go up to do sacrifice in the house of the Lord at Jerusalem, then shall the heart of this people turn again unto their Lord, even unto Rehoboam, king of Judah. They shall kill me and go again to Rehoboam, king of Judah." Whereupon the king took counsel, made two calves of gold, and said unto them, "It is too much for you to go up to Jerusalem. Behold, thy gods, O Israel, which brought thee up out of the land of Egypt," he said, "the one in Bethel and the other put in Dan." You know how this turns out. Jeroboam creates a problem out of thin air. It's a problem with how his people worship. If these 10 tribes from the north go to worship in Jerusalem, that's in the south. And I'm afraid if they go back down there, the glory of God gets falling and their hearts are going to turn away. It could jeopardize my power. And we don't know how long, but it wasn't too long before Jeroboam is introducing a new way to worship. By the way, God had already chosen the place. He's going to choose a new place. We're going to go to Dan and Bethel. God had already chosen the priesthood. He said, "We're going to get new preachers out of different tribes." God had already chosen the periods of time. The entire nation of Israel comes in the first month, the third month, and the seventh month. They all come. But if you read verse 31 and verse 32, he creates a new feast on the eighth month. There wasn't a major feast in the eighth month. He just makes it up. Everything is new. Nothing old is retained. It is worship of some sort, but it sure doesn't look like anything it used to be. And come to find out, Jeroboam did have a lot of Egypt in his heart, and it comes out in his worship. And I wonder if the men of Israel knew that that came with the package. When they came and chose Jeroboam, they weren't saying, "We want new gods, we just want lower taxes. We're not asking you to bring idolatry into the land." If they had known what was in his heart, perhaps they would have said, "You can't be our king." But they presumed a loyalty to God that didn't exist. Boy, loyalty is a word you don't hear much about anymore. You know what Mountain View Baptist Church needs? It needs men and women and boys and girls who are loyal. You've got to be loyal to your church. You ought to be of the mindset, "I'm not leaving this. You can't run me off from here." You ought to be loyal to your preacher. Don't be of the crowd that goes preacher shopping every 2 years because he said something you don't like. No, don't be that kind. No, your preacher ought to know. Your preacher ought to know, whatever church you're from tonight, your preacher ought to know that when the next hard patch comes, you're going to be standing there with me. Your wife ought to know that. Your husband ought to know that. Your preacher ought to know that. Your church ought to know that. And I simply say tonight that before you marry that young man, don't assume that he knows God. Is he on the same page as the way that you were brought up? Does he have the same convictions? Does he have the same heart for God that you have? Why would you date someone when you have spiritual questions? Why would you marry someone when he may not have any spiritual depth to him? One day, if God tarries, your preacher will preach his last sermon in this church and God will take him home. And you'll have to do what you never dreamed. You'll have to call a new preacher. When that time comes, don't assume that he believes the King James Bible. Don't assume that he has standards and he's going to hold the line of separation. Don't assume that he's God's man because he has good pulpit mannerisms. I could take you to 100 churches that made the assumption and they assumed wrong. Ask. What is your prayer life like? Tell us about your worship life. What do you really, really believe? Don't make a choice presuming a loyalty that may not be there. How do you make the best choice? Is your choice the product of much prayer? Will your choice pry open the door of the world? Does your choice presume a loyalty that is not there? Fourth question. Does your choice pick the easy over the best? Do you know why they chose Jeroboam over Rehoboam? They won. wanted it to be easier. Nobody wants a hard life, but it depends on what you have to give up in order to have an easy life. The criteria was that we believe it will be easier under Jeroboam than Rehoboam, so we choose Jeroboam. They chose the easiest path, but the easiest is not always the best. God can make all of our lives easier, but it wouldn't necessarily be better, because God brings hard things in our life to grow us and to strengthen us. I asked for strength that I might achieve. I was made weak that I might learn to obey. I asked for health that I might do greater things. I was given infirmity that I might do better things. I asked for riches that I might be happy. I was given poverty that I might be wise. I asked for power that I might have the praise of men. I was given weakness that I might feel the need for God. I don't know what the future would have held for Israel under Rehoboam. I don't know how the story would have gone, but they said our choice is Jeroboam. We don't need to pray about it. We've already made up our mind. We're not concerned that he spent the last 9 years in Egypt and he has a lot of Egypt ways about him. We don't even know for sure what kind of worship he's going to promote. We presume that we'll still be able to go to the temple. But this will be easier. The choice makes more sense. It's more logical. It's better for our fortunes. We'll be able to keep more of our money. It may not be the best choice, but Jeroboam, we choose piano player, would you come tonight? Young, older Christian gentleman in London. He was getting up in years and he wanted to give each of his servants a gift. So he called his service together and said, I want to thank you for your years of service for me. He said, I want to give you a gift. He said, I'm going to give you a choice. He said, I give you a choice of either a 20-pound note or an old Bible. Whichever one you want, that's what I'll give you. He turned to the butler who had been with him for so long and he said, butler, what would you like? Would you like the money or would you like the Bible? And the butler smiled slyly. He said, well, sir, I can't read, so the Bible wouldn't do me any good. So if you don't mind, sir, I'll just take the money. The old man was disappointed as he gave the butler the 20-pound note, and the butler chuckled silently under his breath. He had pulled one over on the old man. He turned to the gardener. He said, gardener, which would you have? And the gardener said, well, sir, my wife is so ill, I need the money to buy the medicine. If you don't mind, I'll take the 20-pound note. The old man turned to the chauffeur. The chauffeur stroked his chin and he said, I've had my eye on a fine new hat. 20-pound note will do the deed. I'll take the money. He turned to the cook. The cook thought for a minute and she said, I've never owned a store-bought dress. That 20-pound note will make that dream a reality. I'll take the money. And finally, the old gentleman turned to the errand boy. He said, sonny, I've got a 20-pound note. I've got an old Bible. Which choice would you make? The errand boy thought for a minute. He said, I've never owned a 20-pound note. I've never held that much money in my hand at one time. And I've often dreamed what I would do if I ever did. But I know that my mama always read that book. I don't know much about the Bible, but I know it gave me the best mama a boy could ever have. Sir, if you don't mind, I'll take that old Bible. Christian gentleman handed that old Bible, tattered and torn, to that errand boy. And when he did, a gold coin, a gold piece fell out from the pages and fell to the ground. The little errand boy stopped. He picked it up and he said, oh, sir, you forgot this coin. He said, oh, no, son. Whatever is in that Bible, it now belongs to you. They began to leaf through that Bible. There was a 10-pound note and a 20-pound note and a gold coin and a silver coin. And all through the pages of that old Bible were treasures after treasures. but what hidden treasures that God has prepared for your life. If you'll simply say, it may not be the easiest, but I'll make the best choice today. Heavenly Father, thank you for the privilege of preaching tonight. I don't know who I've preached to, but you do. If there's somebody in this room that's facing a decision, I pray tonight that you give them wisdom, give them discernment, give them understanding. I know that they want to be in the center of your will in every decision that we make. Help us tonight. Help us to ask these questions when it comes time to make the choice, to make the best choice tonight. Have your way in this service, I pray. In Jesus' name, preacher, you come tonight.
Pre-71. Have thine own way, Lord.
There's no shame at all in slipping out of that pew, coming down here and talking to God about what's your about decision you're fixing to make. Come on. All right, come on. We got time. We got plenty of time. That's right. In the balcony, on the lower level. Come on. Sing a second verse, you ready? Sing it.
Have thine own way, Lord.
Can you really pray that and sing that song? Do you really mean it? Do you really truly mean that song?
Search me
and try me. Sing it, church, sing it.
Master today.
These are praying and they're playing softly on the instruments. You pray, you preachers, you pastors. You know, we're always available, right? We're always available. Talk, fellowship, counsel everybody. You know what disturbs me, Brother Chad? It disturbs me when people want to come, they want to counsel, want to talk, hour, two and a half hours, and I come home and tell my wife, and she says, what'd they say? You know what I say? Not always. You know what I say? They already had their mind made up.
Yeah.
Why'd they just take an hour and a half of my time for counsel and discussion, which we gladly give. Somebody help me. Yeah. We gladly give. Dangerous thing to make your mind up before any spiritual input at all. Let's do one more verse, and then we're going to take a 5-6 minute break, get the youth choir up here, maybe a song, another special. We're going to have our second preacher, Dr. Joe Arthur. Let's do one more verse first, and then we'll break.
Have thine own way.
Lord, help every one of us.
Power, oh power, surely is thine. Touch me and heal me.
Savior divine.
Savior divine.
I may appreciate the truth of God's word tonight. Don't leave unless you tell him. You're going to have a chance here in just a moment. between the services. We're going to take 5-6 minutes. Brother Cam, let's let the youth choir do one, and then maybe the men's trio. Y'all do one, and then we're going to have our second preacher. You're dismissed for just a moment, all right? Don't leave, all right? God bless you. Our youth choir can be filling the ranks. Our youth choir can be filling the choir loft. Thank you. Let's get a seat, everybody. If we can, let's get a seat. I want Pastor Shelton to come up here just a minute, and I want our congregation to see a great, great, great big answer to prayer. Somebody help me. This dear brother pastors the Gateway Baptist Church in Spartanburg, Bowling Springs, and actually his ladies are having a ladies' fellowship tonight, right now, and I appreciate him coming over here, Brother Hyatt, right here local on 221, several more, but a few months back, this dear brother to my left, he was up yonder at the hospital, and the kidneys had shut down. And you know what? Literally, I think I can honestly say this. Churches all over at least the southeast, we're praying, God touch this dear preacher. God help this preacher. And guess what? Guess what just up and happened? God helped him. And his kidneys started working again. I mean, he was facing like dialysis, like, you know, 3 or 4 days a week, 4 or 5 hours at a time. And I want to publicly thank God for touching our brother. And I love you. And I love you. And I want you to pray and ask God to bless this youth choir. Say something if you want to. All right.
Well, thank you for praying for me. I do appreciate that more than you'll know. And I don't know anything else but to say thank you, folks. Had you not prayed, and I mean this, it's been the prayers of God's people that turned this thing around. I mean that from the depths of my heart. And I went back last week to the kidney doctor, and they checked my kidneys and are doing as good as they were, and they got off the dialysis. And they said it can go off 6 more months, then go back. So I'm headed a little bit further between the visits. And I thank the Lord for it. I'm back full strength, preaching meetings, preaching at church. And I thank the Lord for that. Amen. And I'm glad God still can. He ain't gone out of business. He's still able to exceeding abundantly above all we could ask or think tonight. Amen. He is still God tonight. I bless his name. I bless his name. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Oh, what a great God. Hallelujah to his name. I appreciate you praying. I mean that. Thank you. Thank you from the depths of our heart. Let's pray together. Father, I thank you, Lord, tonight for your mercy and for your grace. Lord, I thank you for the wonderful day you reached down in the muck and mire sin and lifted me out. Thank you, Lord, for being my friend, for being my helper, for being my God. I thank you and I praise you tonight. Lord, we thank you for the word of God we've already heard, how it helped our heart. We bless you for it. Help this sheep choir. Help Brother Joe as he'll preach in a minute. Lord, give him unction of the Holy Ghost. I pray it stir our hearts, bring yourself glory, and we'll praise and we'll thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.
God bless your heart, brother. Isn't that great? Great. We sent some text out a little while ago, and I'm not kidding right here. We told the guys, some of the guys on the prayer circle, we should have been single file, running out of this church this morning, all the way down to the Red Rooster. And you know what? We'll do it again. Amen. Why? Because we're just excited about what God can do. And by the way, we're excited. They didn't love us when we were unloving. Amen. All right. Y'all worship with us.
Jesus saves. Thank you.
proud of them, and we appreciate them. If you ever are interested in a CD, you can go on our YouTube channel and our website. Well, the website's under construction. It's almost finished again. But you can order a CD, and you'll enjoy that good music riding down the road. This is one of our trios, and I hope the Lord will bless your heart while they sing. And then right after they're finished, we're going to have our last preacher for the entire Jubilee. I got a text today and said we ought to go 3 more days. I wish I had someone. Lord have mercy. It's been good, ain't it? Been good. Been good.
Ago, I gave up on Jesus. I told him that I'd had enough. I threw in the towel because I had my doubts that he'd ever love me so much. So I come here tonight because someone asked me to try him just one more time. Little did I know this friend I had forsaken was sitting on the same pew as mine. He didn't say you're sorry for giving up on me. I just felt his tender embrace. He said, remember all the times you were down in the valley. I covered you with my grace. It was then I recall the times of my struggles. It was God who had carried me through. I said, Lord, I'm so sorry. Will you please forgive me? And here's what I'm gonna do.
I'm gonna pick up my towel. I'm gonna go one more mile. Never let me down. He never lost a fight. And it's not gonna start tonight. I'm gonna walk down the aisle and go one more mile and pick up my towel. I'm gonna pick up my towel. I'm gonna go one more round. I have someone in my corner who's never let me down. He never lost a fight. And it's not gonna start tonight. I'm gonna walk down the aisle and go one more mile.
Appreciate the song, don't you? I appreciate this man of God. We love him so much. He preaches literally all over the nation. He really does. Preaches all over the nation. Don't know how he does it. Stays busy. He's a pastor, and he's also travels just about, I'm going to say, 48 weeks out of the year, maybe 50. But this is Dr. Joe Arthur from Atlanta, Georgia, and preacher, you got all the time you need.
Amen.
You got all the time you need. We'll go fellowship afterwards. It's Friday night. So let's enjoy the man of God while he preaches.
All right. Thank you, my dear brother. Mark's Gospel, chapter number 5. That is sweet words to a preacher's ear. Just take all the time you want. But I know there's a lot of deaths you'd rather die than be preached to death. And we'll be conscious of that. Man, I've had a great time this morning. And again tonight. I'm sorry about last night. And I love this church. First time I preached here, I loved it. I love your pastor. He makes me feel so young
and energetic. And I love this. I'm going to start doing that. I just love that. And I got me a new move. Amen. And I love him so very much. And I love the people in this area. And this is a special area God has, through the years, chosen to make himself known. And you're fortunate. You're blessed. I go places all over America. They've never seen one good church. They've never seen one move of the Holy Spirit. They've never seen anybody shout. And man, we've been so blessed. Amen. And I'm glad to be here tonight. I won't waste any time, but I hope you'll come to the 72nd annual Greer Baptist Camp Meeting. It's the last week in June, first week in July. It's just 30 minutes from here if 85 is open. If 85 is not open, it'll be 2 weeks from here. But we'd love to have you come. We got a great lineup this year. Dr. Jack Treber will be with us. Kenny Baldwin will be with us. David Gibbs will be with us. Joyce Myers will be with us. I mean, we're going to have a great time. Local choirs, the Primitive Quartet. We're going to have a good time. So come and be with us if you can. And thank you so very much for the opportunity to be here tonight. Mark's Gospel, chapter number 5. And we'll begin reading tonight in verse number 22, Mark 5:22. And behold, there cometh one of the rulers of the synagogue, Jairus by name. And when he saw him, he fell at his feet and besought him greatly, saying, My little daughter lieth at the point of death. I pray thee, come and lay thy hands on her, that she may be healed. And say this out loud with me, and she shall live. And Jesus went with him, and much people followed him and thronged him. Now, we'll leave off the narrative in verse 24. We'll pick it back up again in verse number 35. And the reason why we do that is this. While Jesus is on his way to touch this little girl, that's when that woman with that issue of blood presses through that crowd and touches Jesus, and Jesus touches her. Now, there are two things about that that I like. Number one, you can't get lost in a crowd. It doesn't matter how many people are trying to get to the Lord, he always recognizes the individual. You can't get lost in a crowd. Let me tell you what kind of Savior Jesus is. He can save 10,000 people at one time, yet save everybody one at a time. He's a personal Savior. There's something else about this I like. It is no secret what God can do. There are no boundaries and borders or limits to what God can do. And I'm glad that he's not so busy while he's on his way to help somebody, he can stop and help somebody else. We pick the reading now again in verse number 35. And while he yet spake, there came from the ruler of the synagogue's house certain which said, Thy daughter is dead. Why troublest thou the master any further? I don't know who this messenger was, but whoever it was doesn't know much about Jesus. Because this man is not troubling the master. And by the way, when you and I call upon him, we are not troubling him. We've been invited to the throne of grace. The work of Calvary has given us access to the throne of grace. You are not troubling the master. He wants to hear from you. Verse 36, and as soon as Jesus heard the word that was spoken, he saith unto the ruler of the synagogue, say this with me, be not afraid, only believe. For the sake of time, watch your Bible in verse number 42. And straightway, the damsel arose and walked, for she was of the age, underline this, we'll get it in a minute, it's real big, for she was the age of 12 years, and they were astonished with a great astonishment. And that little phrase there, great astonishment, means they looked at each other and went, wow. And aren't you glad tonight the kind of God we serve wows you and I? I believe before us tonight is one of the most vivid and clear pictures of intercessory prayer that you'll find in all the Bible. I love the words of Paul to the young preacher. He said, I would that prayers and supplication and giving of thanks and intercession be made for all of the saints. I'm glad tonight for the doctrine in the Bible called intercessory prayer. The prayers that we pray on behalf of each other. And let me say it like this tonight. If there's somebody in your life or somebody in your world that loves you enough to pray for you, then you are a blessed individual. I believe tonight the greatest thing you can do for somebody is pray for them. I believe tonight the greatest thing somebody could do for you is to pray for you. And I'm glad for those people who have prayed for us in our lives. In fact, most of us are sitting here tonight as a direct result of somebody praying for us. I'm glad tonight the God that we serve is a God that we can get a hold of. And I'm glad the God that we can get a hold of can go get a hold of somebody else because we went and got a hold of him. Can I say that again? I'm glad the God we serve we can get a hold of. And he can go get a hold of somebody else because we went and got a hold of him. And I believe the Bible is filled with place after place where somebody touched heaven for somebody and God moved in a mighty way. I believe tonight that Abraham touched God and touched heaven for his nephew Lot. I believe tonight that Moses touched heaven and touched God for the nation of Israel. I believe tonight that those apostles touched God for that infant and that early church. And I know one thing, one day Jesus Christ touched God for all of us because there is one mediator between God and man, and that is the man, Christ Jesus. I'm glad the God we serve tonight is the alive God. I'm glad the God we serve tonight is the able God. I'm glad the God we serve tonight is the awesome God. I'm glad the God we serve tonight is the amazing God. But I'm glad the God we serve tonight is the accessible God and the available God. And he is a God that can be touched with the feelings of our infirmity. I believe churches have seen revival because somebody got a hold of God. I believe broken families have been put back together because somebody got a hold of God. I believe that nations have been brought back from the brink of destruction because somebody got a hold of God. I believe drunken daddies got to be sober daddies because somebody got a hold of God. I believe wayward sons and daughters have found their way back to God and home because somebody got a hold of God. Boy, aren't you glad when you was a sinner, lost and undone, a half a heartbeat from hell, somebody prayed for you and somebody touched heaven for you and they got a hold of God and God got a hold of you. And that's what we have tonight in this passage. We have a daddy with a daughter and the daughter is about to die and daddy can't help her and so he goes and gets Jesus. And Jesus comes back and does for the daddy and the daughter what the daddy couldn't do for the daddy or the daughter. And I'm glad the same Jesus that was accessible in this passage is the same Jesus that's accessible in this room tonight. I'm glad the same Jesus that was alive in this text is the same Jesus that's alive in this place tonight. And the same Jesus that was awesome and amazing in this passage is still the same awesome and amazing Jesus in this place tonight because he is able to do exceeding and abundant above all that we ask or think. And there are no boundaries and borders and limits to what God can do. Notice in our text tonight three things about this intercessory prayer. Number one, I want you to see in the text tonight the mandate that drove this man to Jesus. The mandate that drove this man to Jesus. You say, well, Pastor, why would you use such a strong word, mandate? Well, let me say it like this. What would cause this grown man to leave this little girl and go all the way across town and bow down at the feet of Jesus and beg him like a little child to come and touch that little girl. What would make a grown man do that? Well, I've already told you in the introduction. He is a daddy with a daughter. He is a daddy with a daughter. And if you didn't get that point, then you are not a daddy with a daughter. Because a daddy with a daughter is a ruined man. A daddy with a daughter is a man that dangles from his pocketbook from the pinky of the little daughter. Why a daddy with a daughter will do things he said he would never do. He will go places he said he would never go. He will buy things he said he would never buy. All because that daughter looked up at him with that manipulating look she got from her mother and said, "Oh, Dad, please." You say, "How do you know that? I'm a daddy with a daughter. I'm a daddy with four granddaughters. I'm trying my best to catch up with Dr. Steve Griffith. Pink truck, pink rod and reel, pink shotgun, pink camo. My soul, somebody have some boys around here." Boy, that little girl came to me the other day, said, "Daddy, I just love to hear you preach the word of God." I said, "Honey, leave God out of it. How much money do you need?" Boy, I make my brags all over this country how I hated cats, and the best cat was a dead cat, and there'd never be no cats at my house. Oh, one day that daughter looked at me and said, "Daddy, can we get a cat?" Guess who got a cat? I put my foot down. I said, "No, you listen to me. That thing's a stinking animal, and it's going to stay outside. It's not coming into this house." And one night the lightning flashed and the thunder rolled and the wind blew and the rain descended. And she said, "Oh, Dad, flea flea is outside." And the storm came. She said, "Please, can the cat come inside?" Guess who came inside? Guess who jumped him to bed with me at 4 o'clock in the morning? And I put my foot down. I said, "You listen to me, that thing's an animal. And if it gets sick, it's dead. I'm not going to spend my hard-earned money on a vet. If that thing gets sick, it is going to die." One Monday morning before I went to the airport, I had to make some hospital calls, and I didn't know that Flea Flea had climbed up in the motor of that car during the night. And so when I went out and started the car, fur flies everywhere. Man, I threw the hood open, and there it lays across the hood. You say, "What did you do?" I called 911 is what I did. Man, I wrapped that cat up in a towel. I put that thing in a box. Man, I got in the car. I turned on the emergency flashers. I ran over crippled people and blind people and old people. I slid into the parking lot of the vet on two wheels. I ran in there and threw down my credit cards and said, "If that stupid thing's got nine lives, I ought to buy two of them before I get out of here." I did all of that because that little daughter has done crawled up here in my heart, and she has a special place. Oh, when you come to this text tonight, here is a daddy with a daughter. But in this text tonight, they're not having a birthday party. In this text tonight, they're not having a graduation party. In this text tonight, they're not having a sweet 16 party. According to the text tonight, they're having a death watch, because the Bible said she, the little girl, was at the point of death. That little expression, the point of death, it means her next breath may be her last. Her next heartbeat may be her last. The next second that ticks off of the clock may be her last. She is at the point of death. And notice in the text tonight who and what this daddy was. The Bible said he is Jairus, the ruler of the synagogue. That phrase tells me a couple of things. Number one, he is a man of authority. He is a man of high position. He is a man that tells other grown men what to do, and they have to do it. But yet he does not have enough power or authority to command the disease to leave the body of that little girl. You know what's happened to Jairus in this text? He has realized for the first time in his life, he is up against something that's bigger than him. He is up against something where his power and his position and his authority is not enough. And may I say to this congregation tonight, if you live in the real world long enough, you will come up against something that's bigger than you and more powerful than you, and your authority will not be enough. But I've got good news tonight. When it's bigger than Jairus, when it's bigger than you, when it's bigger than the church, it's never bigger than God. It's never greater than God. We have a little power, but he has all power given unto him in heaven and in earth. He's a man that can command a band of soldiers in the synagogue, but he is powerless to tell the disease to leave the body of that little girl. Notice what the Bible says about Jairus. He's the ruler of the what? The synagogue. He is not a drunk. He is not an adulterer. He is not a fornicator. He is not a cusser. He's not a stealer. He's not a wine bibber. No, he's a good, moral, religious, upstanding man. While they wouldn't get a crook and a thug, they wouldn't do that. They wouldn't do that to get a man to be the ruler of the synagogue. He is morally clean. He is religiously upright. He is a good religious man. But Jairus found out something in this text that one day all of us are going to find out, that being religious and being moral and doing what's right does not isolate nor insulate any of us from the storms and the troubles and the trials of life. Some of the greatest Christians I ever met had to walk through some of the darkest places. I beg you tonight, in the name of the Father and the Son and the sweet Holy Spirit, do not swallow this prosperity gospel that's permeated over the internet and the television and the radio waves, that if you're right with God and you're in the will of God, you won't ever have any problems and you won't ever get sick. I'll tell you, Paul would have a problem with that. Job would have a problem with that. I got a problem with that, because being spiritual, going to church, does not insulate us from the storms of life. You say, well, why do we go? Here's why we go: because we got a refuge and a place to go and a God to trust. Until the storm passes by and the clouds roll back, we've got a Savior. That's why we still go. His power's not enough. His authority's not enough. His religion's not enough. I see something else in this text tonight. He has to be a man of means, or a man of money. He has to have some kind of money. You say, why is that? Well, he's got a piece of land. He's got a house, he's got a wife, and he's got a daughter. And it takes money to have a piece of land. It takes money to have a house. And you put a wife in that house, and a daughter and a wife in that house, Bubba, somebody better have a job. Let me tell all of you young fellas in the courting stage, the greatest way to get your girlfriend's mother and father to like you, have a job. Can I get a witness in the church? Oh, money, money, money. It takes money. And watch this. Jairus has enough money to buy land. He has enough money to build a house. He has enough money to have a wife and a daughter. But he doesn't have enough money to buy that girl's health. He doesn't have enough money to buy her one well moment. He cannot buy what she needs. He cannot merit what she needs. He cannot earn what she needs. He cannot command or authority what she needs. Boy, you talk about a desperate man. He is in over his head. It's beyond his pocket, and it's out of his hand. You say, preacher, it's been a long time since I got on my knees and begged God for something. You know what you just told me? It's been a long time since you've got to the end of yourself. But can I tell you tonight, sometimes our authority's not enough, and our position's not enough, and our morals is not enough, and our religion's not enough, and our money's not enough. But I've come to tell you tonight, when it's out of your power, it's always in God's power. Hey, when it's over your head, it's always under his feet. I want to tell you tonight, when I'm not enough, he's more than enough. When I've run out of power, when I've run out of means, when I've run out of morals, when I've come to the end of myself, that's when a sovereign God steps out of the glory world and rolls up his sleeves and says, I can do what nobody else can do. You know what I love about Jairus? His desperation drove him to Jesus. You say, what's so big about that? Well, after pastoring the same church for 35 years, I've seen desperation do the opposite, drive people away from Jesus. Drive them away from the Bible. Drive them away from the church. Oh, when the storm comes and hell's moving on you and you got 40 acres of torment to deal with, that's not when you quit going to church. That's not when you quit praying. That's not when you quit reading your Bible. You better get that Hebrews 10:25. So much the more as you see the day approaching. You say, but you know, preacher, we ought to serve God in the good times, not just in the bad times. Yeah, you got that right. But I want to tell you, when my money's not enough, and my goodness is not enough, and my authority is not enough, I'm glad there's a God in the glory world that's got more power than me, more goodness than me, more money than me, and he can do what I cannot do. Woo! Boy, one of the greatest things Jairus had to do was swallow his pride and admit, I'm whooped. Boy, I see Jairus as he leans over the dying body of that little girl. I see Jairus as he presses her lips to her fevered brow. I see Jairus as he trembles as he begins to speak in her little ear, baby, baby, I'm sorry. Daddy's got a lot of power, but I don't have this kind of power. Oh, Daddy's tried to do right, but this is bigger than Daddy's doing right. And honey, I've had to buy some things for you and your mother, and I've been able to supply most of your needs, but baby, this one's too big for Daddy. My bank account's not big enough. My goodness is not big enough. My authority's not big enough. But hold on, darling. Hold on, sweetheart. I've heard about another father, and I've heard about another daddy who's got more power than me, who's got more goodness than me, who's got more money than me. Hold on, baby. I'm going to go get somebody that can do what I cannot do and go where I cannot go and say what I cannot say. Can I tell this congregation tonight, when it's out of your hand and beyond your pocket and over your head, standing somewhere in the shadows is a faithful, sovereign, almighty God who has the power, who has the morals, who has the mean. Go get somebody that can do what we can never do. The mandate that drove this man to Jesus. Number two in the text, and I want you to see the mission that directed this man to Jesus. He is a man on a mission. Do you realize tonight how much courage, raw faith and courage it took for him to leave that little girl, turn his back, walk out of that house, and go in the opposite direction? If you don't realize how hard that was, then you're not a real man. Because you know what a real man says? Bring it on. You know what daddies are for? To fix things. Solve problems. Boy, if you don't think I'm right, remember back in Christmas, your wife buys your kids something and it came in 9 billion zillion pieces. And so you put the kids to bed and she says, okay now, Frank, let's put it together. Boy, Frank goes and gets his pliers and his roll of duct tape. And with a real man, you can build an empire with a pair of pliers and rolls of duct tape. Boy, she reaches out there and says, now, Frank, would you like for me to read the directions? And if you are a real man, that offends you. You say, nope, don't read them directions. Nope, you just turn that box this way. Let me see what it looks like. You let me see that picture, and you give me my pliers and my duct tape and Big Daddy or get her done. It's midnight, and it's still in 1 billion pieces. It's 2 o'clock in the morning. And it's still in 1 billion pieces. It's 4 o'clock in the morning. And it's still in 1 billion pieces. And there she stands real kindly, smoke running out her ears, flopping them directions. Frank, if your name's Frank, I don't mean any harm by that. Joe, if you, oh, and finally, old Joe and Frank and Steve and Eddie and Luanzo, they realize, hey, man, I'm whooped. And finally, you look at the directions. And in a few minutes, the duct tape and the screwdriver and all of it comes together. Man, it's hard for a man to say, I can't do nothing else. This is bigger than me. I'm in over my head. But the greatest day in our life is when we realize it is bigger than us. It is out of our hand. It is beyond our pocket. But there is a God who's got bigger pockets and bigger hands and all power. The greatest day in our life is when we let go and go get God, somebody who can do what we cannot do. Oh, I see Jairus as he kisses that little girl, leaves her in the hands of a sovereign God. I see Jairus as he walks down the cobblestone sidewalk, and I can see somebody say, Jairus, where are you going? I can hear him say, I'm going for deity. I'm going for sovereignty. I'm going for omnipotence. I'm going for faithfulness. Jairus, how far have you got to go? And I hear him say, for her, not too far. But Jairus, how long is it going to take? And I hear him say, for her, not too long. But Jairus, what have you got to go through to get to him? And I hear him say, for her, not too much. And can I just say to the daddies in this room tonight, for God to get a hold of one of our young'uns and for God to get a hold of one of our babies, it is not too far. It is not too long. It is not too much. To get God to invade our house, it's not too much. Woo! I believe God said amen to that point. Oh, I can see somebody say, Jairus, 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 are you going for the priest? And I hear him say, no, I'm going for the great high priest. Jairus, are you going for the doctor? No, I'm going for the great physician. Jairus, are you going for the lawyer? No, I'm going for the lawgiver. Jairus, are you going for the prophet? No, I'm going to the God of the prophet. Jairus, are you going for the shepherd? Well, kind of, but I'm going for the good shepherd and the great shepherd and the chief shepherd. I'm going for somebody whose hands are bigger, whose pockets are deeper. Hey, I'm going for somebody that can do what I cannot do, go where I cannot go. And the greatest day in our life is when we realize we can't, but God can. We can't, but God can. Woo! You know what I love about Jairus? He knew where to go. You know what I love about Jairus? He knew who to go to. You know what I love about Jairus? He knew how to talk to him when he got there. For when he saw him, he fell at his feet. You say, what's so big about that? Whether he goes home with you or not. I was riding down the road the other day trying to stay awake, and I turned the radio on, and this radio preacher said, stay tuned for the next 20 minutes. I'm going to do an exposition on prayer. And after about 2 seconds, I realized he didn't know nothing about prayer. He said that Greek word ask means to command. So the next time you pray, you just order God and you command God. I said, sir, you're crippled way upstairs. He's a half a French fry short of a happy meal. Whoever heard of a private commanding a captain? Whoever heard of a sheep commanding a shepherd? Whoever heard of a disciple commanding a master? Whoever heard of a wife? Well, anyway, I'm just telling you, brother, you don't order God, you don't command God, you fall at his feet and worship and plead and beg. He knew how to talk to him when he got there. You remember those two sisters in John 11, Martha and Mary? Got same mama, got same daddy, got same brother, live in the same house, eat the same food, but boy, they're different. Their brother gets sick, they send for Jesus. He doesn't get in a hurry, because you don't have to get in a hurry when you're the great physician. And if your patient dies before you get there, when you're also the resurrection and the life, you don't know any emergencies. And finally, Jesus comes to town, and here comes Martha. Man, she gets up in the face of the Lord. If you'd have been here, my brother wouldn't have died. He said, hey, your brother's going to live again. And boy, I believe Martha was Baptist, because she starts quoting scripture to the man who wrote the book. Let me just say this tonight. If quoting scripture when you pray helps you pray, by all means do it. But if you're quoting scripture when you pray to remind God of what he said, he remembers. I know he's going to live in the last day of the great resurrection. And Jesus said, you read my lips. I am the resurrection and the life. He says, hey, where is your sister? Oh, Jesus, Mary, she's off in a little old solitary place. She's been a snubbing and a crying for 4 long days. Boy, you preachers want a sermon out of preach. He said, you go tell her to come, because the master's calling for thee. Son, old Martha runs in that room, whispers in her ear, the master's come and he's calling for thee. Son, she barrels out of that house. All those mourners think, wow, she's going down out of the tomb to weep some more. But she makes an abrupt turn, and she doesn't go to the tomb. She goes to the resurrection and the life. And when she gets out there to where Jesus is, she says the same thing her sister says, but her position is different. Her disposition is different. Her attitude is different. She said the same thing. If you'd have been here, my brother wouldn't have died. But notice where she said it. When she fell at the feet of Jesus, she begins to weep. Oh, if you'd have been here, my brother wouldn't have died. And while she's mired up at the feet of Jesus weeping, about that time she feels something hit the side of her face, and it runs down her cheeks, and she looks down and she looks up, and not only is she crying, but Jesus has gone to cry, and his tears got to mingling with her tears, and her tears got to mingling with his tears. You say, what is that? If you'll get out of God's face and quit accusing God and blaming God and blessing God out and fall at his feet and adore God and worship God and weep for God, business is going to pick up. He knew how to talk to him when he got there. Boy, I read this. It said, and he besought him greatly. That little word beseech is the same word in Romans 12. I beseech you therefore, brethren. And it means to employ. It means to beg. It means to pull on the heartstrings. He's down at the feet of Jesus, and he's pulling on his heartstrings and said, oh, please. And I love what Jerry has said. If you will come. And boy, this phrase jumped out at me. If you will come and lay thy hands on her. He didn't come and say, look at her. He didn't come and say, speak to her. He said, come and lay your hands on her. There was something about the hands of Jesus that it birthed faith in Jairus' heart. You say, what was it? Well, for the last 3.5 years, he has watched what he has done with those hands. With those hands, he has made the blind to see. With those hands, he had made the deaf to hear. With those hands, he had made the lame to walk. With those hands, he had cleansed the leper. With those hands, he had fed the hungry. With those hands, he had watered the thirsty. With those hands, he had comforted the feeble. With those hands, he had raised the dead. And he said, you know what? I believe there's enough power in those hands. Aren't you glad there is a hand tonight that's a powerful hand, an omnipotent hand, a sovereign hand? Thank God it is the Almighty hand of God. Oh, boy. But watch what happens in the text. He said, if you will come and lay your hands. You see, for 12 years, she's been in daddy's hands. For 12 years, he has held in his hands. For 12 years, he has rocked in his hands. For 12 years, his hands had provided everything that she needed. But oh, now he realizes, my hands are not big enough. My hands are not powerful enough. So you know what he did? He took her out of his hands and he put her in the Savior's hands. Can I say the greatest day in your life and in the life of the person you're praying for is when you take them out of your hands and put them in the Savior's hand. Aren't you glad tonight? It's good to know that when it's out of your hands, it's in the Savior's hands, the capable, eternal, almighty hands of God. He laid her in his hand. And I love the text in the Bible said, and Jesus went with him. And I want to tell you tonight, he'll go home with you too. Boy, the same God that went home with Jairus is the same God that'll go home with every individual in this room tonight. He got a hold of Jesus. He got a hold of God. And he's on his way. Help's on his way. You say, I got a lost loved one. What am I going to do? I got a wayward daughter. What am I going to do? I got a mountain of a problem. What am I going to do? Swallow your pride. Admit your will. And go get somebody that can do and say what we cannot do and say for ourselves. Number three, and I'm done. The mandate that drove him, the mission that directed him. And number three, notice the miracle that delighted this man. That's the only way you can explain what happens in this text. A miracle. I got a wild imagination. Can I use it? Boy, I see Jairus. He's got Jesus by the arm. And brother, they're going back to that little house. I can hear him say, hey! Hold on, baby. Daddy and Jesus is a-coming. Daddy and Jesus is a-coming. And that's when that large crowd began to throng them. And all of a sudden, their progress is halted. And they're standing there in the crowd. And they can't go anywhere. I want to say this about Jairus. He's a pretty good man. Because if that had been me, I'd have got me a ball bat. And I'd have said, get out of my way. I got to him first. We got to get some help. But watch this. He has so much faith now, he can wait on the Lord. Watch this. He has so much faith now, he can watch God work in somebody else's life and not his at the moment and not get mad, bitter, or jealous. Why, he has so much faith now, he can watch God save this one and meet that one and save that one because he knows he's touched him. His turn's coming. For they that wait upon the Lord shall not be denied nor disappointed. Woo! That woman reaches through that crowd and touches Jesus. And I don't know if she was Baptist or not because the Bible said she felt it. But not only does she feel it, the Lord felt it too. You say, ain't it good to know you're saved? Yeah, and it's good to know that God knows I'm saved. He felt it too. And he turned to that crowd and said, hey, who touched me? And can Brother Joe just give you something tonight? When an all-knowing God asks questions, he ain't hunting information. Well, Brother Joe, if God knows everything, then why does he ask questions? Because he's creating an opportunity for you and I to get honest and get real. Who touched me? And I see that little bony hand go up. It was me. And she said, Jesus, can I tell you why I touched you? Now watch now, Jairus is just kind of hanging out watching all this unfold. She said, Jesus, I have been sick for 12 years. When that woman said 12, Jairus said, oh my, 12. That's how old my little girl is. And if he can heal somebody that's been sick for 12, he can heal somebody that's been alive for 12, because 12 was 12 no matter how much you cut it. And just when he's about to explode, the big one drops. Jesus looks at that woman and says something to her. He only says two other times in the King James. Jesus looked at her and said, daughter. Jesus called that woman his daughter. And when Jesus called that woman daughter, Jairus went, oh my. Did he just call her daughter? He's got one too. He knows how I feel. He knows what I'm going through. He's walking in my shoes. He feels my pain. He's sympathizing with me. And I believe he says, you know what? If he can heal his daughter, he can heal my daughter. If he can save his daughter, he can save my daughter. If he loves his daughter, he loves my daughter. Because he's in the daughter business. He's in the daughter business. He's in the daughter business. Woo! And finally, they walk in that house. And how many believe tonight you get more than you ask for? He asked the Lord to touch her. Jesus did two things. He spake to her and touched her. And said, damsel, arise. And he took his hand and he lifted her up and she walked. And here's how I know they were Baptists. Because the next thing they did, they gave her something to eat. The greatest way to celebrate a miracle of God, eat about it. That's what they did in the life of Israel. Every time God would perform a miracle, they'd eat about it. And by the way, how do you think we're going to celebrate God's crowning work, the redemption of lost sinners at the marriage supper of the Lamb, at the table of God, where Christ himself will serve us? He found us in the tomb. He took us to the tree. And now we're on our way to the table where we'll celebrate the goodness of God upon us. I got a wild imagination. Can I use it one more time? How would you like to have been at the supper table, or if you're up north, the dinner table, that night when that blessing was said? That little family sitting there, and I believe Daddy, before he prays, that daughter said, Daddy, before you pray, I got something I want to say. You've been a good daddy. You've been good to me and Mama. But Daddy, the best thing you ever done for me was that day you went and got Jesus. Yeah. Yeah. 2008, my hero passed away. My daddy, he was my hero. He's my buddy. Taught me how to hunt, taught me how to fish, taught me how to shoot a gun. taught me how to get a girl. Woo! I asked him one time, I said, how come you didn't teach me to play golf? He said, we're Christians, son. We've got convictions, and we don't dabble in the things of this world. I said, oh, Dad, is playing golf a sin? He said, son, if you play the way I play, it is not a sin. It's an abomination in the sight of God. Can I run one quick rabbit and just say, you're looking at one preacher's boy out of an independent Baptist church that's not burnt out. I get so sick of hearing that. Well, my daddy, well, get over it. I'm glad he wasn't a drunk. I know he wouldn't have been a wife beater because my mama would have beat the devil out of him. But I'm just telling you, I thank God for my heritage. I thank God for my heritage. I am not ashamed. In fact, if you're keeping notes, write this one down that Brother Jawather said on a Friday night. I'd rather be an old-time Christian than anything I know. I'm not trying to shake my identity. I'm trying to get more of it. I'm okay. I just had to get that out of my system. But, Brother Randy, I've been thinking about what I'm going to say to Daddy when I see him. And boy, I'm glad the next time I see him, he won't be in a coma. He won't be sitting up in the bed, Mama feeding him because he can't feed himself. He'll be in a glorified body in the robes of glory. I think I may say something like this, Daddy. I love you, and I sure did miss you. You've been a good daddy, but Daddy, I got to tell you the greatest thing you ever did for me. Ooh. Daddy, the greatest thing you ever did for me. Oh, was that Friday afternoon when you was laying in a hospital bed and you were moments away from death and a soul winner came by and you got under conviction, Daddy, and you got saved and you brought God to our family. Daddy, the greatest thing you ever did was when you got God on us. I'm telling you tonight, somebody needs to go and get God, and he can do what we cannot. I do. Let's stand together. Preacher, you come. Piano player, whatever. And let me just say it like this. I like preaching up a storm. Let me say it like this. Is there anybody in your world you love enough to go get God for? Is there anybody in your family, anybody in your life you love enough to go get God for? If you know somebody tonight that needs a miracle, know somebody that needs a move of God, if you know somebody that needs God to do something in their life, let's just get down here and call on God. Call their name out to God. Fall at his feet. Beg, worship, plead. Because I'm telling you, the same God that went home with Brother Jairus, the same God that will go home with you tonight. He has no respect of persons. He don't love anybody's daughter no more than he loves yours. And he don't love yours any less than he loves somebody else's. He just soon move in your family's anybody else's. He said, I wasn't raised with a Christian heritage. Start you one tonight. Start you one tonight. The little girl lived because Daddy went and got. Somebody go get him tonight.
All of my trials.
He'll go home with you. singer, son.
In my distress,
he hears and answers prayer.
He kindly helped me. He ever loves and bears his own.
Sing that chorus with him now.
I must tell Jesus, I must tell Jesus, I cannot bear my burdens alone. I must tell Jesus.
Somebody go get him.
I must tell Jesus.
Help's on the
Jesus
way.
Jesus can help me. Jesus alone.
Tim, let's sing that chorus again. Everybody now.
I must tell Jesus. I must tell Jesus. I cannot bear my burdens alone. I must tell Jesus. I must tell Jesus. Jesus can help me. Jesus alone.
I need to sing the chorus.
I must tell Jesus. I must tell Jesus. I cannot bear. Jesus can help me. Jesus alone.
I told Brother Arthur, he doesn't know this, but being the under-shepherd here, you know there's needs in this congregation. You know what they need? An intercessor. Somebody go get the Lord. Can I tell you something? We've been doing that. You know what? He's here to help you. He's here to help you. You sure need to let him. Sure need to let him. Thank you. Thank you. That great message. Thank you. All God's people saying,
amen.
I appreciate it. Appreciate both men of God preaching to our hearts tonight. I'm going real slow because it's pouring out there. We're getting the carports open. We're getting the lights on the car on under the carports. It's storming pretty good, so we'll go in just a minute. But tonight, and they need a few minutes, the workers. Tonight's menu is beef, chicken, or steak taco bar. Beef, chicken, or steak taco bar. Every topping imaginable. Plus, we have leftovers, which would be the pork steak that we had today, the chicken patties we had the other evening, still all of it very moist. Baked potatoes, macaroni and cheese,
Heath Bar cake, cookies, probably some of the peanut butter and jelly sandwiches, and royal closing night banana splits. Somebody say amen. I wish I had my Wednesday night crowd. Banana splits.
They're not going to be directing traffic.
Okay.
And the van is under the awning out here. It's raining sideways, so y'all be safe.
Okay. Okay.
We got one van.
What do you mean, one van? Oh, okay. If you don't want to get wet, I got you. If you want to get on the van, they'll carry you across, okay? They said it's raining sideways. So just take your time. Be safe. We want everybody to stay. We want everybody to stay and eat. We've got plenty of food. It's already been bought and paid for. I'll tell you what let's do. Let's get these two up here. Let's get them right here. Come right here, gentlemen, both you two. And let's shake their hand. Because I'm trying to give them some time. And then all the other preachers and pastors, missionaries, evangelists around you, shake their hand as well. Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you both for preaching. Come right down here by the floor, if you will. Let's shake their hand. Let's stop being a great, that's the keys Brother Jeff preached with. But please stay. Please, we want you to stay. Plenty of food. All right. Brother Brother Jeff Johnson, I think I saw you, didn't I? Yeah, come up here, Brother Jeff. Yeah, I want you to pray with us. This brother's launched out in a brand new ministry to help the worldwide harvest missions with Brother Dean McNeese. He has some information for you, you pastors. He's like a field representative, missionary helping, and just anything that the World Harvest Missions needs, this dear brother's going to be doing. So if you would like to talk to him, that'd be great. And I want to welcome Miss Julie, your wife. Wave at me way in the back. That's Brother Joe's wife. Sister, you don't know it, but through the years, you've been the subject of numerous illustrations. Numerous. And 99% of them has been positive. Once in a while, he says something, you just makes you wonder, is she really like that? But she's not. She's not. He's just ministerially speaking when he does that, all right? All right, Brother Jeff Johnson. Pray with us, Brother Jeff. Ask the blessing of the food.
Our Heavenly Father, Lord, it's an honor and a privilege to be with God's people tonight on a Friday night. We're not at a bar. We're not even wanting to be there. Lord, we want to be here where the Word of God is preached. And Lord, we're so grateful that was done. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for Jubilee. We thank you, Lord, for Mount View Baptist Church and all that has taken place behind the scenes to make this happen. We thank you, Lord, for the sacrifice of your people to be a blessing to us. And Lord, I pray that you bless those that have cooked, all those that have cleaned, all those that have prayed and prepared. And Lord, this is a big event, and no doubt there's so many things that took place that we don't even see. But Lord, you saw it all. We pray, Lord, you'd reward them and you'd bless them. Lord, we thank you, Lord, they did it with a cheerful heart to serve you. And Lord, we pray, God, that you'd help us to hide the word of God in our heart. Thank you, Lord, for it clearly being presented to us tonight. Lord, I pray, God, if there's one lost, they not leave this place in that shape. Lord, I pray you'd save them before it's everlasting too late. We pray, Lord, you bless this food to our bodies. Lord, we'll be sure to give you and you alone the glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.